Well, it had to happen at some point. The Ducks have lost a game in the month of November in 2021, and thus the 8-game winning streak is officially history. It was a good run, but the streak is over as we lost to the Carolina Hurricanes on Thursday.
That Hurricanes game was absolutely unacceptable. The refs screwed us in every waking moment. Well, maybe not every waking moment, but they still screwed us. There were a couple terrible calls that should have been penalties against Carolina, and maybe then we even got away with some, but it was a bad bounce. Bad bounces happen, but they could have not had that happen. So that was a tough loss, but I do like, even for my overly loyalness, how the Ducks are playing good hockey. All of the games that we have seen, with the exception of that one in Winnipeg earlier in the season, the Ducks look like a different team than they did last year.
Thank you for sharing your opinion, overly loyal Ducks fan. So for today's episode of QuackCast, we're going to talk about the previous three games that we played. We will talk about the games versus the Canucks, the Capitals game from Tuesday, and the latest game, the loss on Thursday versus the Hurricanes. Unfortunately, we couldn't weather the storm there. So with that all being said, let's go get started with QuackCast. Canucks game. So the Canucks sought revenge after Troy Terry ripped out the hearts of all Canucks fans in Vancouver, winning that game in overtime. And they would get off to a really good start, outplaying us throughout the first half of the first period and getting a goal from Nils Höglander on a good pass assisted by Quinn Hughes and JT Miller, 1-0 for Vancouver. The Canucks would take a penalty, however, in this game early on, as this penalty was Vancouver penalty, number 95. 4 minutes. You can't do that. So in 4-minute power plays, if you score within the first 2 minutes, you get allotted a 2-minute power play after the goal. If you don't score within within 2 minutes, but you still end up getting a power play goal in that sequence, the power play will be over at that point.
Interesting.
And thus would be the case for Trevor Zegras, who would pot goal number 3 on a slap shot one-timer on the power play.
This power play that we have seen from this unit at times this season, 25 seconds and the man advantage. It took them nearly the full 4 minutes, but they get it done. The game is tied.
When you're wide open, you should give the puck to the guy who is wide open. He can do things like that. Trevor Zegras with the one-timer, a power play goal. He would add another power play goal in the second period. And then Sonny Milano would team up with the aforementioned Trevor Zegras to convert this pretty pass to score our third goal of the game. Here it is.
Up the right wall, keeps it in once, tries again, it bounces in front, and Fowler, careful with it, and pulls out his lob wedge and clears. And it's right to Zegras at the line, got it across to Milano, score on the backhand! Wow. Milano's third of the season.
What you just saw there was what happened to that defender trying to defend versus Sonny Milano. It backfired. That plan backfired against him. Milano with the gorgeous backhander roofs it top shelf on Yaroslav Halak. 3-1 for the Ducks. We effectively outplayed Vancouver in this game with great offense, plugging up the neutral zone throughout the game. And John Gibson, as of course is mostly tradition, plays a great game once again. And we would effectively seal the game for sure in the third period with the Henrik empty netter, and Sam Steele chips in for his fourth goal of the season with 25 seconds remaining.
Most impressive.
But now we get two of the beasts of the East. It's my variation of best in the West.
Terrible.
So let's go to Tuesday, and we will have the Washington Capitals come to town. The Washington Capitals, this was a matchup that I was looking forward to because I mentioned in the preview episode, I love watching Alexander Ovechkin. But the funny thing was, Alex Ovechkin was practically invisible on the ice. He had one shot in this game, and it came in the third period. Like, the Ducks effectively shut him down, as one of, and he was one of my big names to watch. Early in the first period, Ryan Getzlaf sitting on 999 points coming into this one on Tuesday, and he's going to get a pass over to Cam Fowler. Here he comes! Here he comes! What will he do?
Across the top of the zone, Orlov at the left point. Feeds it down low, sealed off on the inboards by Manson, moves it up, and Terry got enough of it. Ducks have numbers if they hurry, because Fowler jumps into the rush. He'll find it and score! Ryan Getzlaf is going to pick up the point here as it's Getzlaf that makes the cross-ice pass for career point number 1,000.
A historic, record-breaking goal for Cam Fowler. Well, the record doesn't go to Fowler, my friends. It goes to the captain, Ryan Getzlaf. With that pass, it will be an assist for him. 1,000 points for Ryan Getzlaf. The first in Ducks history to do it in his 17th season, as you heard John Aller say. Let's all give a big tip of the cap to Ryan Getzlaf for achieving this historic milestone. And then another fact somewhere hiding in there. Troy Terry gets the secondary assist, extending his point streak to 15 games. Again, the goal from Fowler assisted by Getzlaf, his 17th, and Terry his 10th assist. We would go to the third, and the Capitals' alarm clock rung in their heads, or maybe it was something that Coach Peter Laviolette said, and we would get a shot from the point from Garrett Pilon, from Martin Fehervari. It would be scored by Garrett Pilon on a tip for his first NHL goal, and John Carlson would get the secondary assist. And then, precisely halfway through the third period, Trevor Zegras would capitalize on a turnover, goes backhand, and roofs it over Vitek Vanacek. And that made me say Capital, whoa! So we would go late in the third period. I don't know if the Capitals pulled their goalie at this point. And then, from the point, we get a shot from John Carlson, tipped by Tom Wilson. He tips this in, confirmed after review, no high stick, and the Ducks' defensive coverage breaks down to tie the game. This game will go to overtime. Not much happens in overtime until the man, the myth, the legend himself, Trevor Zegras, steals the puck right here.
Finishes by him. Great battle. He's got to settle down a puck now. He's got to cut against the grain. Kuznetsov was quickly there to challenge, but somehow Zegras gets this shot around the stick of Kuznetsov.
And the Ducks win in overtime. And that was another milestone night, capped off with a milestone win, because along with Getzlaf's 1,000th career point, that was the Anaheim Ducks' 1,000th franchise history win. 1,000 wins all time since we became the Anaheim Ducks Mighty Ducks in 1993. And then we will go to Thursday. And I kind of precursored this earlier in the episode, but the Ducks would lose 2-1. And I watched this game. I actually got to watch this on the TV. I watched this while I was working out. I was a bit surprised. I did not like the first goal we gave up, though it was a great pass from Martin Natchez to Ethan Bear, and watching how that play happened was grisly.
Bruh.
And it's 1-0 for the Hurricanes. Later on in the period, Troy Terry and Adam Henrique would come in on 2-on-1. Our former Ducks goalie Frederick Anderson makes the save, but Troy Terry pots the rebound goal to tie us at 1s. And this extends Troy Terry's point streak to 16 games.
Impressive.
As we venture into the third period, a rather perplexing call occurs here because Carolina's number 24 has been awarded a penalty shot. It was a pretty bad call from what I heard from Ducks fans, granting Seth Jarvis a penalty shot. So here we go. Seth Jarvis versus John Gibson, a man who has a few years of NHL experience versus the rookie in his 8th NHL game. The two shall do battle right now.
But in just his 8th NHL game, his first NHL penalty shot, Gibson comes out to challenge.
What a save!
No problem. John Gibson, that was way too easy for him. Remains 1-1. However, Seth Jarvis would end up getting the last laugh as the Canes would intercept a puck handled by Nick Delorier. Kevin Shattenkirk would kind of stop it, but he fumbles the puck. Gibson would rob the Hurricanes player coming in, but then Seth Jarvis comes in and the puck just barely rolls over the goal line, not able to be cleared out in time. The Hurricanes score. And at this point, the Hurricanes did a great job of plugging up the neutral zone and effectively shutting down the Ducks offense as they weren't able to stretch the ice or get pucks deep, dump it in, and try to win a puck battle in the corner. And it would eventually result in the Hurricanes ending the Ducks' 8-game winning streak. The Hurricanes win this game 2-1 as it was a hurricane of emotion that the visiting team ended up getting the victory in. And with this, the Ducks will travel to Nashville and Colorado to begin a 2-game road trip on Monday. Let's go over those two matchups. The Nashville Predators are first up on this mini 2-game road trip. They just came off a loss to the Montreal Canadiens tonight. That's not really good considering that the Canadiens were 4-13 coming into that.
Ooh.
The Nashville Predators are 9-7-1, which is a very solid record with 19 points. Our Ducks come into this matchup at 10-5-3. The Predators have some really good players that we do need to watch for, and historically in Nashville, at least within the last few years, that building has not been kind to us. So the players to watch: Matt Duchene, who they got as a big free agent acquisition a couple years ago, is off to a hot start with this year with 16 points in 16 games, has always been good versus the Ducks. 9 goals, 7 assists for those specific totals, and as I mentioned, 16 points, 16 games. Mikhail Granlund, who they got in a trade for Kevin Fiala, who I've talked about a few times on this show, has 16 points in 16 games as well, with just 3 goals and 3 assists. And in their last 5, respectively, Duchene has 4 goals in his last 5, and Granlund has 5 assists and 6 points. Defenseman Roman Josi, who is a very offensively gifted defenseman, can score you some goals, but he plays really good at the point, maneuvering pucks around there. But another guy who seems pretty underrated this year for the Predators is Tanner Jeannot, number 84. He scored already a couple of highlight reel goals this year. So Duchene, Granlund, Josi, and Jeannot are my 4 guys for you to watch on the Predators. The next game will be versus the Colorado Avalanche that Wednesday in Colorado. While the Ducks may have fared historically better all-time versus the Avalanche, that team's offensive attack is scary, and they've got some elite passers, goal scorers, and playmakers in any combination of those. Specifically, we need to watch for the captain, Gabe Landeskog, who signed a big 7-year extension during the offseason, for 14 points in 12 games, with a +9 rating, 6 goals, 8 assists. Nazem Kadri, who is essentially the Tom Wilson of this team, has 19 points in 14 games this year with 5 goals and 14 assists. Devon Taves, a very good defenseman, is a +7 in his last 5 games. And Andrei Burakovsky, who's a very underrated forward, has 5 goals in his last 5. For the Ducks to watch these next couple games, Troy Terry, obviously, with the big point streak. Hopefully he can continue that. Ryan Getzlaf as well. Hopefully he can continue to get more assists. Specifically, Terry leads this team with goals at 12, 22 points in 17 games. So it's about a point and a third per game, if I'm doing my math right. Getzlaff, 19 points in 18 games. Leads the team in assists with 18. Yeah, he's on fire. And defenseman Hampus Lindholm, like Taves, is a plus 7 in his last 5. So got some pretty good matchups coming up here with all of this last 5 stuff and all of the great players to watch that I've just mentioned.